Everyone, and thank you for joining us once again on our bi-weekly update call. Before we start, again, may I please ask all of you to please mute your microphones. If you would like to ask a question, this is what the chat function is for. You can ask your questions in English, Spanish, and Portuguese. And the presentation and the recording will be made available during the course of the afternoon, and we will send the email to everyone as we've done in the past. Gracias por acompañarnos otra vez hoy. Antes de empezar, le puedo pedir por favor que pongan sus micrófonos en mute. Si quieren hacer una pregunta, por favor, usen la función del chat. Pueden hacer las preguntas en inglés, español o en portugués. Como siempre, durante la tarde, les vamos a mandar un link con la copia de la presentación y la grabación del discurso. Então, boa tarde a todos. Obrigado para su participación hoy. Antes de comenzar, por favor, peço a todos os participantes que coloquem seus micrófonos em modo silencioso. Se você gostaria de fazer uma pergunta, por favor, use a função do chat. Você pode fazer a pergunta em inglês, espanhol ou português. Mas ainda a resposta será em inglês ou espanhol. E a apresentação e a gravação será disponível após da chamada em um link. Muito obrigado a todos. And I think I saw Peter online already at some stage. And I know you're a bit tight for time today. So with that, Peter, I hand over to you to start.
Marcus, thank you very much. Bon dia, buenos días a todos. Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you again for joining us for the regional update on the current situation in Latin America and the Caribbean. As Marcus has said, I'll give a few introductory words with a presentation in English, but I'm very open to take your questions in either English, Spanish, or Portuñol, or Portuguese, and we'll do our best to translate back. On today's call, I would like to give an overview on a few important topics we feel are critical for the media and our readers and audience across the region. One is the financial outlook by countries in the region, the developments across Latin America and the Caribbean over the past 2 weeks, our stance on quarantine measures, which we just came out with a few days ago, and many states in or many countries in our region are implementing. And then a quick explanation on the needs on waiving the 80-20 slot rules for the upcoming scheduled season. And of course, at the end, I'll be very happy to take your questions. Let me start by saying that as an industry, we are ready to restart. The takeoff protocols agreed by ICAO are the blueprint for ensuring that air travel does not become a vector for the transmission of COVID-19. Unfortunately, even though all countries in the region are members of ICAO, several states across our region still need to implement these guidelines. We are now heading into the fourth month of suspended operations, and our airlines are continuing to bleed financially. Just as a reminder, information that we shared with you recently, the industry on a global scale is expected to suffer a net loss of $84.3 billion for this year, 2020, very different from what it was in 2019. And for our airline space in this region, in Latin America and the Caribbean, it's expected to post a loss of $4 billion in 2020. This equates to a loss of $27 per passenger. And that's down from the minimal 45 cents per passenger profit, which we had originally predicted or estimated for 2020. with air travel in this region not set for a major restarting in the coming weeks, we have updated our forecast. And for Latin America, we now predict that $98 billion of GDP supported by the air transport sector is at risk, along with 4.1 million jobs. If we compare to North America, the contribution of $406 billion to the GDP in aviation is at risk, placing some 3.3 million jobs at risk. And as you can see from the slides, we're expecting revenue losses of between 52 to 81% compared to 2019 in the different markets. It should therefore not come as a surprise that last week, LATAM Argentina announced that it was ceasing operations following the footsteps of Avianca Peru and TAME in Ecuador. And yes, we do understand that the governments are all placing the emphasis on fighting the virus, but they cannot continue to ignore our sector, which in many cases is the backbone of connectivity and social economic well-being. From our stand, we will continue to advocate for financial relief. In Argentina, AANA, the air navigation service provider, has deferred fees to the end of the year, but we're still waiting for the government to assist in greater financial support, in the same manner that buses and the country harbors have been given the financial relief. Aviation needs the same help as well. In Chile, unfortunately, no progress in providing assistance has been achieved either. In Mexico, the airports operated by GAP, OMA, and AICM, Aeropuerto Internacional Ciudad de México, have responded promptly to the urgent calls from the industry to consider relief, while ASUR, who operates Cancun International Airport, has remained silent. Needless to say, Cancun will play a fundamental role in reactivating tourism in the country. In addition, we're continuing to ask governments in the entire region to work with us to enable the industry restart. And yes, we are seeing some positive developments. We're beginning to see more islands in the Caribbean welcoming back visitors, such as Jamaica and St. Lucia, with others set to allow international flights as of July. And while we fully understand that most nations see the need for testing, we are seeing a divergence in requirements which add complexity and uncertainty to the travel experience. In Ecuador, the opening of further airports has allowed domestic travel to resume. However, in this country, testing requirements for both domestic and international travel and quarantine are hampering the restart of air travel in Ecuador. In Colombia, the industry has made it clear to the authorities that we are ready to restart service, and all the protocols to operate safely are in place, both by the airlines and the airports. The proposed Plan Piloto, which allows individual mayors to decide if they want to open their airports or not, is just not practical. The Plan Piloto have been done by over 800 repatriation flights that have taken place across the region. That is the validation that air travel and the airlines and the airport are operating with the right protocols. The airlines need to be able to commence operations from Bogota and not from secondary or territory cities. A fixed date for the resumption of domestic services is urgently needed by the government of Colombia. In Peru, the government has already indicated that the restart of domestic flights could happen as early as of July, the first week. But the industry is ready to restart today, and we urge the Peruvian government to provide a specific date in July to begin these domestic operations, hopefully during the first week of July. Air transportation and the connectivity it provides to Peru are vital for the country's economic well-being and the many Peruvian jobs that depend on travel and tourism. In Argentina, we are in continued dialogue with the government on the modalities of restarting aviation, as well as renewing our request for the financial relief measures. one impediment hampering the resumption of air travel are quarantine restrictions. Imposing quarantine measures on arriving travelers keeps countries in isolation and the travel and tourism sector in lockdown. Fortunately, there are policies, alternatives that can reduce the risk of importing COVID-19 infection while still allowing for the resumption of travel and tourism, which is vital to jumpstarting the national economies. IATA has supported and will continue to support a layered approach of measures, which are aligned with the ICAO takeoff guidelines. These mitigate the possibility of transmission of cases where people may travel while unknowingly being infected with COVID-19. This is the reason why we urge governments to avoid quarantine measures when reopening their economies. More precisely, we're proposing a layered biosafety measures which reduce the risk of imported cases via travelers and mitigates the risk in cases where an infected person does not manage to travel. These include discouraging symptomatic passengers from traveling, introducing public health mitigation measures, and carrying out health screening using measures such as non-intrusive temperature check. COVID-19 testing for travelers from countries perceived to be high risk, and reducing risk of transmission during the air travel journey and the destination. A layered approach to safety has made flying the safest way to travel while still enabling the system to function efficiently. This should be the framework to guide governments in protecting their citizens from the terrible risk of both the virus and the joblessness. Quarantine is a lopsided solution that protects one and absolutely fails at the other. We need government leadership to deliver a balanced approach. Mandatory quarantine measures stop people from traveling. Recently, public opinion and research revealed that 83% of travelers would not even consider traveling if quarantine measures were imposed on travelers at their destination. A further topic which is essential for an industry restart is slots. Without these, airlines cannot plan their schedules. However, the uncertainty created by COVID-19 is keeping forward bookings at a low level. Given the unknowns, people are booking closer to the time of travel. Historical travel demand trends no longer prevail. And airlines will require much more flexibility to plan schedules and respond to the changing consumer trends. The ability to respond swiftly to market demand will drive their ability to survive. And these decisions by governments and regulators to grant the extension to waive the slot usage rules will remain means that airlines can make these critical decisions immediately. Flexibility on slots use is a key tool to regulators can deploy to support the recovery of the industry. It will help protect schedules, giving airlines, airport passengers, and key travel destinations confidence and consistency. It will help prevent needless flights with very low demands from taking off, helping the environment and airline finances, and allow connectivity to be reestablished to support the economy while reassuring the sustainability of operation. The waivers of the 80-20 slot rules for the current timeline 2020 was a necessity. The waiver needs to be a necessity and must be extended to the upcoming 2021 season. And this needs to be confirmed by July to provide certainty for airlines planning for the upcoming season. The earlier the waiver can be granted, the better, as this enables the airlines to provide a more stable long-term schedule. In closing, I want to point out once again that our industry, air transport, is ready to resume the essential role we play to the socio-economic development of this region before COVID-19 struck. For this, we need our governments to implement the guidelines devised by ICAO and consider providing financial support to the airlines. Airlines across the regions were forced to suspend flights since late March, Last week, LATAM Argentina announced that they will cease flying indefinitely, bringing the actual airline closure to 3, Avianca Peru and TAMI. If this trend is allowed to continue, connectivity across the entire continent will become less connected, both domestically and internationally. This will drastically affect the socio-economic recovery of the region. Unlike other parts of the world, we do not have the luxury of alternatives such as good roads or rail links. Less connectivity means less choice, and less choice usually translates into higher prices. Aviation has played an important role over the past years in enabling more people to fly in this continent, creating business opportunities, expanding personal horizons, and allowing family and friends to connect. Yes, governments need to protect the health of its citizens, but they also bear the responsibility for socioeconomic developments. We as an industry have done all we can do to permit a safe restart. Now we need our governments in Latin America and the Caribbean to provide the necessary backing for this to happen. With that, I thank the time, and I'm ready to take your questions.
Okay, thank you, Peter. Gracias, entonces. Vamos primero al sur, vamos a Argentina. Les adelanto, esta mañana había una comunicación con el ministro de Transporte y quieren saber sobre qué temas han conversado, qué perspectivas haya para cumplir con el 15 de julio para el posible retorno de vuelos domésticos. Y si hay la posibilidad de, adelantar el primero de septiembre para vuelos internacionales de Argentina. So this is basically on Argentina, the recent communications we've had with the government, and if there's any chance for a mid-July restart of domestic and bringing forward the 1st of September date for international flights. Over to you, Peter.
Thank you, Marcus. Hoy tuvimos conversaciones con el gobierno que ha sido ya algo regular con nuestros miembros, con el gobierno de Argentina. Nuevamente, una conversación muy transparente. Hablamos de una serie de temas que es parte de nuestra agenda. Obviamente, el restablecimiento de los vuelos a partir de septiembre, los vuelos internacionales, el apoyo financiero que puede aportar el gobierno. Y las oportunidades que tenemos dentro del marco de los vuelos interregionales o dentro de las provincias en Argentina. Sigue transcurriendo esta comunicación. Hasta el momento, debido a la situación económica del país, todavía no se ha formalizado el apoyo económico que buscamos. Sigue en la mesa del gobierno argentino y seguiremos mirando y buscando alternativas conjuntamente. La fecha del 1 de septiembre es una que todavía está fijada. No hay en estos momentos planes de variaciones, de cambiarlas. Y por el momento vamos por el camino correcto. I'll say very quickly in English. Today we maintain our regular dialogue with the Ministry of Transport of Argentina, which has continued to occur on a frequent basis. Following the agendas that we agreed to discuss, financial support, the restart, both international and domestic. From the financial standpoint, we are still waiting. The government is still not in a position to provide formal communication on more financial support. It is providing it through the deferral of air navigation charges, but we're still waiting for more. The restart is still planned for September 1 for international traffic, and there is at this point no plans to deviate from that.
Okay, thank you. Gracias. And we have similar questions on any update from Chile. So no sé si tenemos algo de nuevo de Chile. Peter, I think you're on mute.
Yeah. De parte de Chile no tenemos nada. Sí, tenemos continuas conversaciones con el gobierno. En estos momentos estamos trabajando con ellos sobre los protocolos de de la reactivación de vuelos, pero por el momento paquetes financieros o otros apoyos, tanto de aeroportuarios o de aterrizaje, todavía estamos pendientes notificaciones tanto por el aeropuerto como por la aeronáutica civil. From English, our conversations with the Chilean government continue. We have not, until now, received a formal response to our request for the financial support, either to the airlines nor the financial support that could be obtained through a reduction in airport or navigation air charges. We're still waiting on that. We have been working very closely with the Chilean government on the restart protocols to make sure that they are in compliance with the ICAO restart plan, and that has been the extent of the dialogue, but it has been continuous.
Okay, thank you, Peter. So I think today we'll work our way kind of from the south back to the north. This is a question coming from Brazil, and are we still waiting, or the aviation sector still waiting, for financial support from the public bank, from BNDES? And, you know, how are the airlines coping without this, and how long can they actually still wait for any financial support from the bank?
My understanding is that the each individual airline is working directly with the bank. Good progress is being made. To my understanding, as of yet, they have not reached the final agreement. It is still ongoing. Obviously, this has an impact. We're now into the fourth month almost that the industry is suffering in terms of almost a total shutdown. In the case of Brazil, it's somewhat different because domestic service has continued, although limited, but has continued. So that has given the flexibility to the Brazilian carriers to have at least a minimum domestic service. International, it has also had the opportunity to fly some international flights. But everything does come to headway when the vast majority of other countries continue to be on lockdown. It will have an impact. So that's as much as I can share on the Brazil. It's good progress is being made, but nothing formalized to our understanding with regards to the individual negotiations between the airline and the bank.
Okay, and with that, let's move north to Colombia. Y la pregunta de Colombia es, ¿cuándo necesitan que vuelvan los vuelos a Colombia? ¿Qué avances se han dado para ello y cuáles son las fechas que se manejan hasta el momento? ¿Cuáles son los protocolos que han implementado en el país? So, you know, when do we expect the return of aviation in Colombia, and also what measures have we implemented or are proposing for the restart of aviation?
Bueno, empiezo en español y después lo resumen en inglés. Como yo he indicado en otras oportunidades, el trabajo con Colombia ha sido muy estrecha desde el comienzo. Colombia fue de los primeros países en dar el apoyo financiero necesario. Ha jugado un rol muy importante en el desarrollo de la documentación de los protocolos de la OACI. Colombia era uno de los países en el grupo de trabajo, pero sí estamos ciertamente preocupados, como había indicado en el discurso, que la industria está lista, la aeronáutica civil tiene los protocolos necesarios, pero hasta el momento esos protocolos no han sido aprobados por el Ministerio de Sanidad. Es urgente, es necesario. Y casi no es aceptable que todavía estemos pendientes casi un mes después que estos protocolos se hicieron, se habían finalizado. Es importante que tengamos unas fechas concretas para la reactivación del tráfico doméstico. Ya se sabe cuándo se va a comenzar el internacional, pero no podemos ir de semana en semana si se abre y no. Y lo que no va a funcionar son los vuelos pilotos, sobre todo entre destinos secundarios. Si el aeropuerto de Bogotá no se abre, es muy difícil establecer la conectividad dentro del país. Y por eso pedimos al gobierno en estos momentos que trabaje con la industria, los protocolos están y que establezcamos ya por una vez cuál va a ser la fecha. Y ya mantengamos esa fecha para que las líneas aéreas puedan ir programando, el pasajero, los colombianos, tengan la expectativa de cuándo va a haber una reactivación. I'll say in English, we have been working very closely with the Colombian government from the outset of the pandemic. They took significant steps to help the industry. At this point, what we need is for the government to establish the date of a domestic restart. We know the international restart in September, but it has become very frustrating for the industry to go week by week, not knowing when domestic service can be reactivated. Using pilotos or as a way, plan pilotos as a way to begin air service between secondary markets is just not acceptable. It is not practical and highly unlikely that it will take place unless you have a Bogota airport or Bogota city in the discussions for that type of operations. And this is why we're asking for the government, one, to implement the protocols, and this needs to be done by the Ministry of Health, and two, for the central government, and again, I repeat, the central government needs to decide when a restart for domestic services will start. I have mentioned in my speech, the plan piloto, the pilot test, has already taken place with more than 800 repatriation flights by Latin American carriers, including Colombian Airlines, that have safely, efficiently worked with the government to bring Colombian citizens back and other citizens of the region back to their home in the region. That has been the validation that air transport using the protocol is a safe means of transportation.
Okay, thank you, Peter. And with that, we move further north to Panama. Got the question from two people, but it's basically the same question. El gobierno panameño extendió por 30 días adicionales la suspensión de vuelos comerciales. ¿Cómo califican esta medida y el efecto que puede tener en el sector aéreo panameño? So this basically is referring to the fact that the Panamanian government has decided to extend the flight restrictions for another 30 days and what effect that will be having on the Panamanian market.
Well, obviously, our markets in the region have had to extend the quarantine or the country restriction because of the spread of the virus, how it is now. We've become, Latin America has become now the epicenter of the virus around the world. And obviously, states are taking the necessary measures to try to reduce the spread of the virus. With that said, again, the industry has worked very hard. And when I speak about the industry, it is not only the airlines, but the airports, the regulators, World Health Organization has been involved to implement protocol that will reduce the risk, the spread, and ensure that air travel is implementing the right protocol to safeguard the vectoring of the virus. What we hope from the Panamanian government, working collaboratively, working together with them, that we do not further extend the quarantine measures, but rather that we implement the quarantine procedures that the Ministry of Health feels comfortable and assured that the industry has implemented global protocols that are being utilized by the government all around the world and that it is safe to fly. I'll say in Spanish, obviamente, en estos momentos, el epicentro del COVID-19 está en nuestra región y Panamá, como otros países, están extendiendo sus su cierre de fronteras por otros 15-30 días. Y lo que esperamos que en el caso de Panamá no se extienda más allí que finales de julio. La industria, el aeropuerto, estamos trabajando muy alineados de una manera de implementar los protocolos que ya han sido implementados por la mayoría de países alrededor del mundo y poder trabajar con el Ministerio de Salud para que se sientan ellos asegurados que estos protocolos que se están aplicando en otras partes van a salvaguardar la salud de los pasajeros y que la industria del transporte aéreo no sea ese vector de transmisión. Así que vamos a seguir, vamos a hacer un llamamiento al gobierno panameño. Primero, asegúrenos que se implementen estos protocolos, que lo tiene que hacer el gobierno. Y segundo, que ya establezcamos esa fecha de reinicio, que esperamos que no sea más allá de la que tenemos establecido en estos momentos.
Bueno, gracias, Peter. Ya vamos un poquito más al norte porque tengo más o menos las mismas preguntas de México. ¿Cómo está la situación en México? Ya hemos recibido alguna respuesta de parte del gobierno y además de la ayuda o del el soporte que hemos pedido de las diferentes compañías de los aeropuertos. So in Mexico, for Mexico, we also have several questions pertaining to any move forward or any sort of response from the government on our request for financial relief, and also what the individual airports are doing in providing relief or in some cases not providing any financial relief.
Okay. Over to you, Peter. Thank you. Bueno, como había mencionado en mi discurso al comienzo, de la parte aeroportuaria sí tenemos que decir que México ha sido uno de los líderes de nuestra región. Los grupos aeroportuarios, incluso el Aeropuerto Internacional de México, Ciudad de México, todos han trabajado de una manera muy alineada, muy conjunta con la industria, entendiendo y nos han dado ayudas para que reducir los gastos adicionales para las líneas aéreas. El único que estamos todavía pendientes es Azul, que el aeropuerto primario es Cancún, y Cancún juega un rol muy importante para la recuperación de la economía, del turismo, del transporte aéreo en el país. Es el único que está pendiente. Nuestras conversaciones con la Secretaría de Transporte siguen por bien, buen camino, aunque no han anunciado más medidas hasta el momento. Sí hemos estado trabajando con ellos en la implementación de los protocolos para esa reactivación. Sí hemos estado trabajando con ellos por la aeronáutica civil o la aviación civil en la extensión de varias normativas aeronáuticas que rigen sobre las líneas aéreas. Eso ha aportado ayuda operativa. Y seguimos trabajando conjuntamente para ver qué otras oportunidades financieras hay. Pero hasta el momento no hemos tenido más confirmaciones de alivios que tenemos. Vemos oportunidades que hay todavía con el tema de IVA, impuestos. Vemos oportunidades del sobrevuelo que maneja SENEAM. Y son las áreas donde vamos a seguir enfocándonos.
I'll say very quickly in English, as I mentioned in my opening words, Mexico, in terms of the airport financial support, had probably one of the leading countries in the region. GAP, OMA, Mexico City International Airport have all provided some sort of financial relief to the industry, which is very much appreciated. These airports have actually even extended the timeline, which is very important to restarting airline operations. The only one that we are still waiting is for Azul, which is the main airport that they, under their concession group or airport group, is Cancun. And we do a call out to this group on the need to have their support to provide the same financial support as the other airports have done. Cancun is a very important airport for Mexico, for connectivity, for travel and tourism,
and we would hope that they would take the same approach as the other airport groups have.
Okay, thank you, Peter. So with that, we'll go to some more, I think, general questions. So I have a few from Mexico on the updated figures. So this is why we now have the slides. So I don't know if you could just make some comments on why the figures have changed since our last update, which is basically based on the fact that the shutdown is a lot longer than we had originally thought. Mira, tenemos algunas preguntas sobre las cifras actualizadas, entonces lo hemos puesto de nuevo en la pantalla y creo que Peter puede hacer algunos comentarios sobre las cifras.
Bueno, Mark, creo que lo has contestado tú, pero bueno, voy a hacer simplemente reafirmar lo que ha dicho Mark. Como habéis visto en el pasado, cuando hemos hablado con la diferencia de ingresos o el impacto de trabajos, etcétera, o de PIB, siempre hemos mencionado que eran para los primeros dos trimestres del año, los primeros seis meses, que cualquier extensión de cierre de fronteras o restricciones obviamente iba a tener un impacto a la industria. Y por eso estamos viendo estas cifras han incrementado a raíz que ahora estamos entrando en el cuarto mes, ya estamos entrando en el mes de julio. La expectativa que en algunos mercados no se va a abrir los vuelos internacionales, sobre todo en mercados grandes, como puede ser Colombia, Argentina.